All getting situated here.
Yeah.
Welcome you. We have a great panel that I want to introduce here today. When they first approached me about the idea of doing something on Sarbanes-Oxley, I said, first of all, we're not going to do anything on Sarbanes-Oxley. So despite what the title says, that's sort of old business. We're living with it. It's sort of like that. But I think it'd be a great opportunity for us to do the following. I think Duke's a terrific and important public institution. And we are able to affirm that day in and day out, and I think this program is the illustration of that, that being able to bring down today four individuals who have terrifically responsible positions at the SEC, been there for a number of times, and to share their experiences with you in terms of the developments and issues that are going on in their division. So this is sort of a mini SEC Speaks. I'll start with Cheryl. Cheryl's the Assistant Director of the Division of Enforcement, is a 99 Duke Law graduate.
Unfortunately,
89. Kristen Broadhead is a 99 graduate and is attorney in the office of Commissioner Nazareth, who was just most recently appointed to the commissioner. Stan Macel. I still mispronounce that, don't I? Macel is how you pronounce it. But Stan Macel is a 92 graduate and is a senior attorney in the Division of Investment Management, which is a group that looks over all of our 401k plans. So we wish him well in doing that. And then we have John Reed Stark, who's branch chief in charge of internet enforcement. Because we only have an hour, and Rich Smallbeck is much bigger than I am, is coming in with his panel promptly at 4 o'clock. Without further ado, I want our panel to start off, and they'll start off, I think, first is Christian, I believe, is the way you've organized things.
Okay, okay. Sounds good. Can everyone hear me okay in the back? Can't tell from up here. Well, no one's raising their hands, so thank each of you for coming out today and listen to us. We're excited to be here and to talk to each of you. Can I get a show of hands? How many are students, current students? Okay, a few of you. Okay, good. You know, I think we really appreciate the opportunity to come back and share our experiences. I think, you know, we've all been at the commission for varying lengths. I've been there for just over 4 years now. And, you know, there really are a lot of developments that have happened in those 4 years. I think we're probably going to focus on some more recent events, but there really are a lot of things that have happened. Before I begin, I must remind you, though, that our remarks represent our own views and not necessarily those of the commission, any of the individual commissioners, Commissioner Nazareth in particular, or the staff, our colleagues on the staff. The past 3 or 4 years have really been an exciting time. Just speaking personally, I joined in February of 2002. I had no idea what I was getting myself into pre-Sarbanes-Oxley. But during this period, the commission has really been involved in a number of, it's promulgated a number of rules, as you know, especially those who are securities practitioners or students. I'm sure there's been a lot of trying to change the case books and things of that nature as they've been updated. And has really instituted a record number of enforcement. And you know, John and Cheryl have a better tab on that. But there have been record numbers of enforcement actions and disgorgement of penalty amounts. And I'll talk a little bit about that today. But a number of recent developments I'll just mention. I'd like to focus on a couple in particular. But just a couple of things, maybe 3 or 4 things kind of give you an idea. And if you want more information on them, you can ask me after the panel, or maybe as others will talk about it. But there's a recent initiative at the commission, and I'm going to focus on things that have happened in the past year or two, just for purposes of timely information. There's the chairman has announced a platform on XBRL, which is a type of, essentially, it enables users to tag data to use data in a way that's helpful to them. I think it you know, my own view, it's probably to address this issue of what to do with EDGAR. And EDGAR is a system at the commission that permits people to file things electronically, but it may or may not be the most, you know, user-friendly system. And I think he's made some initiative and he's taken some steps to really try and make the data more useful. And the commission has instituted a pilot program. It's gotten some volunteers, and that's an ongoing initiative. The commission has also announced recently some interesting insider trading actions. It's revoked issuer registrations en masse for delinquent filers. It approved the NYC Archipelago merger in March. The NASDAQ finally was registered as a national securities exchange in January. Also, the commission has a So there's a secret phone down here for all of those who are wondering. I don't know who's on the other end, but
the White House.
Okay. Is this being recorded? Also, the commission has recently proposed disclosure regarding executive compensation. That's really gotten a lot of interesting press. To focus my discussion today and to not eat up too much time, and I'm guessing there'll be some time for questions afterwards, I'd like to focus on a couple things. One is the recent statement by the commission regarding financial penalties against issuers. And the other is a policy statement regarding subpoenas to the media. And I would ask you to be patient with me. I can't answer all your questions about this, but I can give you the basics. And these are very interesting issues, and they're issues that the commission continues to grapple with. First, if I could start off on the statement regarding penalties. In 1990, the Remedies Act provided the commission with the ability to assess corporate penalties against individuals and corporations. And over time, increasingly, especially after 2000, 2001, and thereabout, you started to see some really large penalties against corporations. And I think the WorldCom settlement was $750 million. And you started to see really large, that was, you know, I think, that one of the largest, but mm-hmm. you started to see some really large settlements. And, you know, the issue arose is, you know, does this unfairly harm the underlying shareholders of the corporations? You know, are they innocent shareholders? Have they received benefit? Are they being harmed if the commission, you know, assesses these penalties against them? And, you know, there was some concern at the commission about that. You had certain commissioners who would agree. Sometimes they would disagree, depending on what the circumstances were. And also in the mix, you had Section 308 of Sarbanes-Oxley. So I will talk a little bit about Sarbanes-Oxley. So
that's okay.
And Section 308 provided the commission with the authority to add penalties to disgorgement. So instead of going, you know, all these big penalties, instead of going to the U.S. Treasury, they have the ability to put them with the disgorgement and actually get it back to the shareholders who were harmed. But, you know, the underlying concern was still there. You know, what do you do, and how do you, you know, what sort of framework should the commission have? And to address that and to provide some transparency, in January of this year, the commission issued a statement regarding penalties, and it set forth, you know, 9 factors, and it provided a framework, 2 principal factors and 7, you know, I guess secondary or additional factors. And I won't name them all, but I will tell you the 2 principal factors, which number one is the presence or absence of a direct benefit to the corporation as a result of the violation. The second is the degree to which the penalty will recompense or further harm the injured shareholders. A couple of the others, the need to deter the particular type of offense, the extent of the injury to innocent parties, and whether the complicity was widespread within the corporation. And what I've seen so far since this has been issued is the commission has taken this very seriously. And you've seen a number of instances, and I see this quite a bit, where the staff will go through factor by factor. And, you know, although these are agreed upon and unanimously approved principles, in application, people have, you know, it becomes more subjective. But I think, you know, the commission is really taking significant action to apply the principles and to abide by them the best they can. The second and more recent event involves subpoenas to journalists. And this, earlier this month, the commission issued a policy statement on this matter. And this arose when, you know, the commission sent some subpoenas to journalists with respect to a market manipulation investigation, and there was some concern expressed about what this really meant and what the commission should do going forward. So what it did is, again, to provide transparency, it announced that it would develop guidelines regarding the issuance of subpoenas. And earlier this month, it did that, just that. In a statement, it basically set forth the guidelines the staff must follow in order to balance really the freedom of speech and the principles underlying with the vigorous enforcement of the securities laws. And you know, some of the highlights, I won't go through the whole thing with you. If you're interested in seeing either of the press releases regarding these two items, I'd be happy to point you in the right direction. But the main ideas are that, you know, first the staff must try to make sure that it strikes the proper balance between the two things I mentioned. You know, the press's interest in the free and the public's interest in the free dissemination of ideas, and also the effective enforcement of the violations of securities laws. When the staff is investigating a matter, I'm looking at the policy statement right now, it must determine whether the information is obtainable from other sources. It must make reasonable efforts to obtain the information from those sources, and it must determine whether the information is essential to the successful completion of the investigation. If the staff makes those determinations, it must seek supervisory approval, and it must enter into negotiations to try and obtain the information absent a subpoena. If that's unsuccessful, they need to, again, to make sure that the information is essential to the successful completion of the investigation, that they've exhausted all reasonable alternative means of obtaining the information through other channels. And if they can make that determination, then they need to seek approval from the director of enforcement and the general counsel, and the chairman must be notified. And I think those are the major components. There are lots of other details, but I think that's about it. I probably have come close to my time, so I'll.
Let me just ask you a real quick question there. I mean, how many internal reviews are there, Bar? Either we're thinking about the sanction, the guidelines for sanctioning the entity, or getting access, subpoenaing papers from journalists. How many reviews would that occur within the agency? I mean, certainly you have the SEC attorney who's carrying out the investigation, but he or she's got individuals that frequently they have to get approval from for certain other internal reviews of these matters before you ever go out and get a subpoena?
I think I understand your question. I mean, you know, what happens internally before they, I think what I understand the statement to say, and enforcement can help me out if I'm off base here, but I believe essentially what occurs is you have the staff attorneys or the others who are involved on the staff at more of the lower level, or the people who are actively involved in the investigation, need to seek supervisory approval of the head of whatever the offices are, the district administrator or whoever the higher levels of the supervisors are in their particular office. And then, you know, they can go ahead and start the negotiation process. You know, that doesn't enable, that approval doesn't enable them to go ahead and issue a subpoena. There are more steps that need to be taken after negotiations. Is that,
it really depends. I mean, I supervise lots and lots of people, and so does Cheryl, and I think it really varies.
Okay.
You know, if I've got a pretty seasoned professional issuing subpoenas, and we've got a formal order investigation, then I'm not going to look at them.
Okay.
But if it's somebody who's brand new, the way my office is stacked, there's always somebody senior looking over the shoulder. But I think the bigger answer is, in a place like the SEC, there's generally deliberation over everything, as opposed to, I served as an assistant U.S. attorney for a short time period, where you're issuing your subpoenas with a lot, the AUSA, the assistant U.S. attorney, is a lot more just sort of doing things on the fly, whereas the commission's grand jury process, which is essentially its investigation, because the enforcement division is so different. It's as opposed to the law and order where, you know, you're separated, you've got the police who investigate crimes, and then the district attorneys who prosecute them. In the enforcement division, you do both.
So you, one day you're investigating and you're issuing subpoenas. The next day you file your lawsuit and you're in court prosecuting the violation. So it's the only agency like that, really that unique. And I think that's why there's such a deliberative process over subpoenas. But it's extraordinary to be sending notice to the chairman, and I think it's warranted. Because anytime you're subpoenaing something like journalists, you've got to be incredibly sensitive. There are a lot of sensitive areas, though. Yeah. You know, you pull a subpoena up, it shows you a red flag. You might bring it all the way up to the director, who might talk to the commissioners because of the nature of the subpoena.
Stan, you're up next.
Thank you. Thanks to Professor Cox for organizing the panel. And for you students in the audience, I remember, it seems like yesterday, being in his securities regulation class and never thinking that I'd, you know, apply that in real life. And here I am, a securities lawyer years later. So you never know. Duke is a, you know, it prepared me well for real life, but I didn't know it. I'd just like to reiterate Christian's disclaimer that I do not speak for the commission. These are my views and do not necessarily represent those of the commission or my colleagues on the staff. And I'd also like to clarify one thing. If you have a question about your 401k, I'm not the right person to ask. I actually work in the Division of Market Regulation, and we oversee brokers and dealers and exchanges. So, I recently worked on a proposed interpretive guidance that was issued in October regarding soft dollars, or as we call them, client commissions. And we'll give you a little bit of an overview about what that proposal is about. And I'll try to keep it broad, because we don't want to get lost in the weeds here, and I want to leave some time for questions at the end. But feel free, if you do have questions afterwards, to ask me about them. On October 19th, the commission issued a proposed release on focused on interpreting the scope of the safe harbor. And this is a safe harbor under it's Section 28E of the 1934 Act, which provides that a money manager who pays more than the lowest commission rate, who gets more than the lowest commission rate from a broker, is not necessarily violating his or her fiduciary duties, even though they're paying more, if they're getting brokerage and research services in exchange for that. And they deem in good faith that the value of the brokerage and research services is reasonable. So the proposed release talks about what brokerage and research services are. There's been, since 1975 was when Section 28E was promulgated, and there's been some question in the industry about what are reasonable brokerage and research services. And in 1976, the commission came out and said, anything that is commercially available is not reasonable. So the Wall Street Journal is not reasonable. Any sort of commercial service is not reasonable. In 1986, because of many comments from the industry, who said that was very confusing and hard to administer, the commission revisited that and said, okay, that we think that the standard is if it's used in as part of a normal and legitimate relationship. Let me get the exact language here. In lawful and appropriate assistance in the performance of a person's investment decision-making responsibilities, then it can be under the safe harbor. Well, since 1986, we've seen some abuses and some questionable activity. In 1998, our Office of Compliance Inspections and Examinations did a sweep of broker-dealers and found that some broker-dealers had been softening things like carpeting, wires used to hook up computers. And these things, in the staff's view, is not part of the lawful and appropriate assistance in an investment manager's decision-making process. So we've revisited the statute once again and proposed some new guidelines. And the new general framework is, first, a money manager must determine whether a product or service falls within the specific statutory limits of Section 28E. So is it an eligible product or services, product or service? And the language in 28E says that it has to provide advice, analysis, or it must be a report. So if it's a research report, or if it's advice about investing, or analysis of a stock, then it would qualify. That's the first part, eligibility. The second part is that the money manager must determine whether that eligible product actually provides lawful and appropriate assistance. So just because something is eligible doesn't mean that it's actually providing a money manager with information to make his investment decisions. So there has to be eligibility and there has to be use. The third prong is that the money manager has to make a good faith determination that the value that is over and above the pure execution price is reasonable in light of the value of the products or services provided by the broker-dealer. That's the general framework. Some of the specifics regarding research is that it has to be the reflect the expression of reasoning or knowledge. So it has to actually have some intellectual content or reasoning or knowledge content. And delivery, including connectivity, is not integral to research. So the wires to hook up a computer are not research. However, they may be brokerage. Commission had not specifically addressed the framework for brokerage before this proposal, but in this proposal, we did address the temporal standard, saying that brokerage services are those products and services that relate to execution of a trade, and they must fall at the point between when a money manager communicates with the broker-dealer for transmitting an order to the point at which funds or securities are delivered. So they have to relate to the execution process, and connectivity, such as transmission of orders, may qualify as brokerage under this, even though it is not research. A couple of the other concepts that we talked about in the proposal were mixed use. That was introduced at first in the 1986 release. This concept is to reflect that some products or services that you may get as a money manager have legitimate investment decision-making purposes, but some you may use for other things that aren't for investment decision-making, such as compliance functions or functions that are outside investment decision-making. And if they do have a mixed use, you must allocate the value that you use for investment decision making and only allow that amount to be softened. Another concept that we talked about was commission sharing. Under Section 28E, broker-dealers must be financially responsible for brokerage and research products that they provide to money managers, and then they must be involved in effecting a trade, in executing a trade. A commission sharing arrangement, which is where you may have an introducing broker and a clearing broker, so that you have two brokers involved in a trade, must be part of a normal and legitimate correspondent relationship. That's the language that has been used in the releases, in which each broker-dealer is engaged in securities activities of a more extensive nature than merely receipt of commissions paid by other broker-dealers. So you can't just be providing research, you have to be involved in part of affecting the trade. This part of the proposed release has brought a lot of comments. We've received over 70 comment letters to date, and a lot of commenters have questioned the commission sharing affecting the trade relationship. So the staff is looking into the comments and considering what to do. What I envision will happen will be that the staff will propose to the commission a final release at some point. My guess is within the next 6 months, regarding to reflect the comments that we've received regarding these proposals. There are some other issues that the release addressed, such as whether market data received about that's purely just trading information qualifies as brokerage or research, and whether copied or repackaged materials may be eligible, and the staff is considering those as well. So that's a broad brush sort of look at the soft dollars release, but I'm happy to.
Are any of these rules sensitive to the question about whether the brokerage service is an affiliated organization? Otherwise, you have one set of criteria. If it's Fidelity Brokerage that's providing the high-cost brokerage service to Fidelity Fund versus if it's some other non-affiliated brokerage firm that's doing it.
That is something that we're considering. But because these commission sharing arrangements are developing as we speak, there are no rules about that.
And when you look at these 70-plus comments that came in, are they kind of divided between investors and providers, or mainly the regulator that's coming back at you?
No, there's a range of respondents. There are some individuals who wrote in who talked about their concerns with soft dollars, and a handful wrote in and said eliminate it.
Yeah.
And there are also regulated entities, both investment advisors and broker-dealers, who wrote in as well. So there's a real range.
Cheryl, I think you're up next.
It's my turn. Let me know if you can hear me. Can you hear me all right? Okay. I'm going to switch gears entirely, because the division that I work in is the Division of Enforcement, and our principal job is to investigate and prosecute potential violations of the securities laws. The disclaimer has been said twice. I guess I can bore you and say it again. These are just my views, and they don't represent the views of the commission or the staff. As the division that investigates and prosecutes potential violations, we look at a wide range of conduct. One big area that we look at is accounting fraud. So what I thought I would do would be to talk to you about a fairly recent trend, which is reaching out not just to the wrongdoers, the companies that actually file the financial statements that have the misstated numbers in them, but also to look at those individuals and parties that help them to do it. In lots of these instances, what we're doing is charging these individuals and companies as aiders and abettors of the principal violation. For example, in the Enron matter, if you look at Enron, you'll also see that we brought actions against some banks that helped Enron to commit that fraud. There are lots of different categories of what we call gatekeepers, for instance, or vendors or suppliers. The traditional gatekeepers I think of as auditors, the board of directors, facilitators might be in the insurance company industry, like the AIG case or the banks and Enron. There's also a wide range of cases involving the retail industry. For example, it might be customers or vendors that help the public company to what we call cook the books. One statistic is interesting. Between July 1997 and December of 2003, we brought enforcement actions against individual third parties for this type of misconduct, assisting in accounting fraud in approximately 30 cases. And they ran the gamut from Enron, for example, where we brought action against Merrill Lynch, JP Morgan, Chase, Citigroup, and CIBC, the insurance industry with AIG, and also a whole host in the retail industry, and I'll walk you through some of those. Time Warner, a company we've all heard of, is one that we did recently. In addition to bringing an action against Time Warner and settling with them to a $300 million penalty for their direct violations, we also charged Time Warner with aiding and abetting violations of three different public companies. Essentially, Time Warner engaged in what we call round trip or sham transactions with these parties, and it allowed those companies to be able to book this fake revenue on their books. Some of the retailers are a little bit smaller. Just for Feet is one that, as you can tell from the name, sold shoes. We brought an aiding and abetting charge against an account manager at Nike, a major supplier. One of the things that you'll find in a lot of these cases is that the supplier will be asked to provide a confirmation to the auditors confirming that the transaction really happened when it didn't. And this is an instance in which a supplier falsified an audit confirm, and we brought an action against that individual. Fleming is a grocery store. And in the grocery industry, there are what we call vendor allowances. Basically, in a lot of grocery stores, you'll notice that products are placed in different places on the shelves, while the suppliers or vendors pay money to be able to get their products placed in certain places or to have ads placed in circulars. And that money is typically called a vendor allowance. It's sometimes a slotting fee or something like that. In a lot of instances, that money goes straight to the bottom line of the public company, the grocery store, for example, or other retailer. So they're very eager to get that. And in a lot of instances, there may be certain things that they need to do before they're allowed to book it. For example, if it's a product that's supposed to be placed on the shelf every month for a year, then they need to have performed a certain percentage before they can record that certain percentage on their books. In a lot of the cases that we have here, the company will get a misrepresentation from the vendor saying that all performance has been done as of the date that they entered into the contract and allow the company to book it all up front. In some instances, they're just fake. There really was no agreement at all. In Fleming, the grocery store, we brought an action against both individuals and against a public company. Dean Foods is the name of the public company, for those sorts of those sorts of misrepresentations relating to vendor allowances. In Kmart, which is another matter that we brought recently in my group, we brought an action against eight individuals who were employed by vendors, charging seven of them with aiding and abetting the fraud, Kmart's fraud, relating to actually entering into agreements with Kmart that said, we're going to give you $2 million if you do the following five things. And then they would enter into secret side agreements so that if the auditors were to look, they would never know what the true terms were and never know that there were these contingencies. And this allowed Kmart to be able to record all the money up front. In a Royal Ahold, which is a fairly large case that we brought recently, we brought actions that were similar to that. But in addition, in Royal Ahold, there was a criminal component. And I think we'll probably see that more as we go along, but I think that Royal Ahold and Suprema are two that come to mind as cases where we not only had civil actions against these third parties, but criminal actions as well. When we make decisions about which way to go and whether we're going to be able to bring an action against not only the public company that filed the false financials, but also these third parties, we have to look at a lot of different factors. One of the things we obviously have to look at is whether we think we've got the facts to support that they knew what they were doing. Just as a little bit of background, for a long time, for decades, there was a body of case law that basically defined the standard for aiding and abetting a certain way and made it clear that all you needed to do was to be reckless. But then there was a decision, Central Bank, which I guess some of you probably heard of by now, that essentially got rid of aiding and abetting for private litigation. We have a commission, a statute that we at the commission can use now to get around that for our own actions. But this has basically put that prior case law in question. Courts are now grappling with what exactly it means to be an aider and abettor, and what do you have to know? Can you just have turned a blind eye? Do you have to know that when you sign that false confirm that it's going to mean that the company is going to be able to book all that revenue and then meet its numbers? It's at this point not very clear where the courts are going to come out. There have been some district court decisions that have said one thing, others that have said another. Some that have said you have to be severely reckless, and others that have gone a little bit lower than that. It's probably going to take quite a while for us to sort all of this out, because we're the only ones bringing these cases, since there aren't the private litigants anymore bringing the aiding and abetting cases. And most of our cases don't go to court. I think 70 to 80, maybe more, maybe a higher percentage of the cases that we bring actually settle. And then of the ones that do litigate, they're not necessarily all going to be accounting fraud cases or have third parties in them. So there's a very small percentage of cases that we're working with to help us define what the scienter level is. Excuse me. But going back to trying to figure out where everything fits, we look at what did the person know, how involved were they in the process, did they backdate a document, for example, did they draft something that was false, was there a side letter, did the auditor come knocking on the door and ask questions, which should have been a red flag. Was this something that happened at the end of this company's fiscal period? Was there some particular push? Did someone at the company say, well, we really need to meet our numbers, it would be great if you would do this for us? Or should they have known that because they were getting this call on December 30th and the fiscal period ended on December 31st? Another thing that we look at is whether we've got enough evidence to go beyond suing the individuals and actually to bring an action against the entity itself. As I said, we've sued some, like Dean Foods and some other large companies. Most of the cases that I've seen involve individuals, and not as many involve the companies. But that's really pretty much all I wanted to say about all of this. It's just, I think, important to notice the trend in which we've gone beyond just looking at the primary wrongdoers and have made clear to the marketplace that we'll continue to look not just at the issuers who commit fraud, but also at the third parties who help them to do it.
How about lawyers on that list?
Well, I didn't mention lawyers because that's a whole other issue, but them too.
Well, tell us about that issue.
Them too. Okay. Them too. And there have been some, not so much in the financial fraud area that come to mind, but there have certainly been quite a few. Sure. It seems like people, you want to wait until we're finished, or?
David, you want to?
Yeah, I wanted to know, how do you enforce for international firms like, let's say, TV Azteca from Mexico that had some problems with the SEC? How do you enforce those companies?
I didn't hear all of them.
How do you enforce your orders against
international companies?
It seems to
transnationally.
It varies country by country as to whether they're enforceable. And we have an Office of International Affairs that guides us through that, because I'm no expert. But it definitely varies. But we've got a lot of cases that we've brought where we've named foreign nationals. A lot of our cases involve accounts that are overseas. We've got memoranda of understanding with a lot of countries throughout the world. Helps us gather information. And they also will work with us in terms of conducting investigations, helping us to apprehend people. I mean, John can talk about this some too, probably from some of his experience. But enforcing judgments and actually getting money from people can be tricky sometimes.
It's tough. You've got to freeze the money when it's here.
If you're talking about money.
Will do.
But if you're talking about enforcing judgments, then yeah.
We had a case, for example, called Cameron, which involved a company called Cameron International. The stock was trading at 6 cents one day, and just a few days later at $90. And it was a microcap company. There was no headquarters, there were no employees, there was nothing going on.
not even the rent. And we found that there were some match and wash trades going, and we found that money was coming from offshore. So we went to court very quickly and froze it before it left. That's always the tough thing. I mean, I've been at the commission now for 15 years. After I graduated here, I was in private practice for two sort of wretched years, and then I found my place in service. And for 15 years, I really didn't know exactly where the SEC fit in. I think during my first year, I was in Washington, and this was before I got married or anything. I was dating this woman in New York, and her name is Allie, and I called Allie one day, and I said, you know, Allie, how's it going? She said, John, I'm so miserable without you, it's almost like you're here. At that point, I understood the SEC a little better. I've also been teaching for 10 years at Georgetown Law School as an adjunct, which is Latin for not a real, an adjunct professor. And I have a website. It's called johnreedstark.com, J-O-H-N-R-E-E-D, as in dog, S-T-A-R-K.com. And you can visit it. It's free. It's got all my course materials, all the presentation materials. You can be the one of the few non-familial people to visit it each week. But please, go visit it and see it. We've brought in I'm chief of the Office of Internet Enforcement, and sort of grew up as a staff attorney right alongside Cheryl. And I found this little niche involving technology around 1994, 1995, and started something called the Office of Internet Enforcement, which is now a pretty big office. And the office itself, just about anybody does internet-related prosecutions. The commission itself has brought about 500 or so internet-related prosecutions since 1994, charging maybe over 1,200 or 1,300 individuals and entities. When I first started teaching, there were just a few no action letters and a few interpretive releases and two cases. And then things just really grew, and now I have a huge curricula that is very interesting and often covers a lot of these areas like international. You know, oftentimes in internet cases, there's an international component to it. One thing we also do in the Office of Internet Enforcement is we service the Enforcement Complaint Center, which was an online mailbox we set up in June of 1996. And about 10 or 15 emails a day would come in, and I would reply to them. And then I set up an auto reply, so people got an auto response. And then I would sort of review them. And it was my job, and together with doing investigations, to look at these. And most of them related to internet conduct. Well, now we get over 5,000 emails a day. And it's an incredible thing. It's instantaneous access to government for anyone in this room or anyone on this planet who wants to tell us about a fraud. And it really works. We just brought, Christian had mentioned insider trading cases. I think we are really very aggressive because that's our bread and butter is insider trading. An anonymous complaint came into our Enforcement Complaint Center not too long ago that talked about a guy who worked for a company called Kinetics who was an executive there, and was apparently using some negative information that he had gotten from the FDA about a drug they had used to cure acne, and that the drug's results were causing problems. And it wasn't likely to get approval from the FDA. And he ended up, at the time that he got that information, buying a lot of puts, essentially betting that the stock was going to go down. And we started watching his accounts as we were investigating. And then we saw him take some money and move it out to buy a house, looked like a house. Well, okay, maybe not time to go in there and freeze all of his assets. It's a house, as soon as we bring our case, we can get to that. Then we saw that more money was going out, and we called his lawyer. We called Charles Schwab where the account was, and we said, can you put a hold on this account voluntarily for just a few days while we sort this out? And they agreed to do that because we were contemplating an asset freeze. So if quickly he tried to get money out, he contacted a lawyer on the West Coast. The lawyer on the West Coast called me and said, somehow got to me through the official at Schwab, and said, you know, hey, my client wants his money and you have no authority to freeze that money. And I said, well, you know, we haven't frozen the money. We've asked Schwab just for a couple days. Would you be willing to agree to some kind of a standstill agreement where your client would just not move that money for a couple days so we can talk to you and we can talk to him? And she said, no, I'm not going to agree to that, and I want you to move that money out right now or I'm going to sue Schwab for conversion.
So, and she said that with about five or six of us in the room. So we quickly put together affidavits and we went to court within a day. We went to the commission, of course, that night and got authority.
That's good, you went to the commission.
Duty officer. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Along those lines, I should mention the disclaimer also. It doesn't apply to me. No, I'm kidding. It applies to me. It's just as much as everybody else. But the reality is, yes, we went to the commission for what's called duty officer, which is when you seek emergency authority from the commissioner who's in charge of handling emergency matters, and we got authority, and then we went to court and went before a judge and sought an emergency asset freeze and got all the relief and froze all of his assets. And then we were granted a preliminary injunction, or they consented to a preliminary injunction a few days later. So the reality, if you're sort of looking for what's going on within the walls of the SEC, we're serious about this stuff. And I think we're fairly nimble, we're fairly agile to move quickly in whatever area that we see violations. In the internet area, we see microcap cases. We see a lot of spam cases. The most recent phenomenon that I think is the most dangerous and certainly something, an area where we haven't brought a case. And what we're seeing sometimes now is we're hacking, securities fraud, and identity theft all combined. Mm-hmm. And it works like this. You wake up one morning and you find all of your money from your brokerage account is gone. And you wonder what happened. And here's what has happened to some people. A hacker goes in, finds out, uses what's called an electronic logging program that they can plant on your computer very easily. Think of all the pop-ups and everything that comes up in your computer. You don't know it's there. And it logs your keystrokes. It logs your passwords, your usernames, and anything else you happen to be typing that day. These programs are completely legitimate. Lots of companies use them to log the keystrokes of their employees. So the keystroke logging program sends the hacker the information about your account and your password. The hacker goes into your account, liquidates all of the securities, and has the cash. Well, one thing about the internet program that I think, of course, it's been a boom for a con artist because you can spread fraud from anywhere on the planet instantaneously to millions of people. But it's also a boom for law enforcement because you no longer have just the trading trail and the money trail. You also have an internet protocol trail, and you also have a resplendent evidentiary record. When these things happen, a website commits fraud, a spam, I can present that evidence to my boss, to the commission, to a jury, to a judge, in first-hand primary fashion. When I first started the commission, everything was three levels over. A witness said, well, I was contacted by this one person who told me this, who told me that, who read it in a document. You don't have that in the internet program. Okay, well, back to the online fraud. So the hacking existed, and the money's in the account. Now, they know that we can trace that money. So you find a straw man to set up a bank account, and then they wire that money from the brokerage account to that bank account. Well, how do you find a straw man? Well, you send them an email, you have home business opportunity, maybe you go to an online chat room, pretend to be their date for a while. You get somebody interested who's got a bank account, and you tell them every $10,000 you receive in your bank account, keep $1,000 of it, and just send $9,000 to us. We've got a business going over here in some emerging capital market or somewhere else, so just send us the money and keep 10% for yourself. Or maybe if it's the online dating area, send me the money and so I can get the money to come to the U.S. and visit you. So that happens. The straw man sets up the account. The money is wired to the straw man. We trace it to there. The straw man withdraws the money, maybe in a big enough trunk to generate a big enough trunch to generate a suspicious activity report by the bank, which is reported to the Treasury Department. But maybe not. The money is taken out in cash, and then they walk into an office like a Western Union and wire that money overseas. And it becomes much tougher to trace because when something like Western Union is done, you can just go with a password. You can walk into a Western Union office. Hand them $10,000 or however much money in cash, say, I want to wire this to some other Western Union office, which might be sitting in a supermarket somewhere in a foreign country. And the person on that receiving end just has to give a code of 10 letters and 5 numbers, and they get that money. And then they leave with it. And the Western Union office might even generate a suspicious activity report. So that online intrusion, that's probably the newest trend that I've seen, and that's what our office is all about, is getting in front of things that are new and innovative that might somehow damage investors, damage the integrity of the marketplace, or upset the integrity of what you're doing. Because more and more people are doing things online. You know, I've witnessed the revolution firsthand, And it's amazing, but you've got to be careful. There actually is a publication on the SEC's website that we put together that will advise you if you're worried about this with respect to your brokerage account, then take a look at the advisory of some steps that you can take. And if you're getting spam or other junk mail or you know about a fraud, email it to us at enforcement@sec.gov. Again, you'll get an auto response from me. And the frustrating part for investors, I think, is that we sort of have to say, well, we can't even confirm the existence of an investigation. But we're passionate about that. We're not going to ever talk about any investigation in any way, shape, or form until we've actually brought that case. We're that kind of prosecutorial office. So we won't even confirm, again, the existence of the investigation. So that's about what's going on in internet enforcement. And I think that leaves some time for questioning.
Yeah, we do have some time for questions. But John, let me ask you a question. Does your office also look to see if there's like false rumors and tips like that on chat rooms, et cetera?
Yeah, I mean, that's, again, a very self-reporting driven thing. There are thousands, if not millions, of message boards. Yeah. And it can either be on the cyber smear side, where somebody's trying to smear a company by spreading false information about them, or it can be on the false promotion side, where somebody's trying to spread false information. We brought loads and loads of cases in both categories.
Questions, audience?
Cheryl, if I could ask you a question about accounting fraud. What's enforcement's attitude toward chief executive officers, public companies who set the wrong kind of tone at the top? They're screamers, they don't accept bad news, their accounting systems are pathetic, but they themselves do not appear to be participants. You know, you don't have a smoking gun email or something. Mm-hmm. Can you say anything about how enforcement approaches a CEO like that?
Well, yeah, I can think of cases we've brought where the CEO has denied knowledge of the fraud. I think maybe Bernie Ebbers is a good example of that. And the jury just didn't buy it. They said, look, this is a guy who was paying attention to the price of even the office supplies. How could he not have known about this widespread fraud? Many of the cases that we bring, one of the things that we look at in terms of maybe resolving it is what was the tone at the top? Is this a widespread fraud? How high up the chain did it go? In terms of bringing an action against the CEO, himself or herself, merely having a position of CEO, it's likely not going to be enough without us being able to establish that person had some awareness of what was going on, particularly if you're talking about fraud, because we have to get to scienter. But with someone at that high level, it's not always as hard as it would seem to be able to establish that someone at that position in the company knew or was reckless, at least, in not knowing about what was going on. It could be that they sent the message down the pipeline for people to meet the numbers that quarter. It could be that they said, I don't care how you do this, just get this done, and then claim to have turned a blind eye. But once you start getting at red flags, once you start seeing perhaps a trend where every quarter they suddenly do hit those targets and you see someone who doesn't seem to have even asked any questions about, hey, how are you guys doing this? Then you start getting your way there. But it can be tough, and there have been lots of cases where if you look at a host of accounting cases that we brought over the years, you'll see a lot of them where we bring an action against perhaps the company and perhaps the CFO, controller, and others, and not the CEO, because sometimes they do insulate themselves, and sometimes they do claim that they had no idea what was going on. But we look very hard at that and have found many other cases where we don't have their fingers on a document, but we felt like we've put together enough circumstantial evidence to establish that they were at least reckless.
Accounting fraud too. I'm curious about the way that John talked about the emails and the tips and so on. What's the funnel for accounting fraud? What's the trend in terms of how cases come up and how do you prioritize them?
Well, in terms of how they come up, we get cases from a lot of different sources. We get cases the same way you guys might find out about things, but by looking in the paper sometimes. We get complaints. We get self-reporting, shareholders sometimes. Sometimes they're anonymous. We had a lot of self-reporting when there was a we'll just call it a pronouncement, a 21A report that came out not that many years ago that said that companies that self-report and do some other things to cooperate in investigation may get, if not a complete pass, at least some sort of a break in terms of what the commission will end up wanting to do to resolve a matter. So we see a lot more times when we'll get calls from a lawyer saying, I represent this company, and they want to come in and talk to you about something they just found out about. And I think that in the past few years, that's happened more than ever. But there's a wide range. We have a division of corporation finance that works closely with us that reviews filings and refers matters to us too. I can think of a whole host of ways. And in terms of prioritizing them, we have a pretty large staff, you can never necessarily tell just from a referral how something's going to go until you take a look at it. So we tend to take a look at everything that we get. I can't give you a percentage as to how many of them turn into real cases that actually get brought, but quite a few do. I think maybe hundreds a year. I don't have statistics off the top of my head, but I would say it's probably in the hundreds.
Cheryl, if I could ask you, how does OC, the Office of Compliance Inspections and Examinations of the Commission, how does that kind of factor into the referrals to enforcement?
Well, OC is a great source of referrals for us. They're the people who are basically on the ground inside the broker-dealers, the mutual funds, doing the exams, and we get a whole host of referrals from them on all sorts of potential violations relating to mutual funds. Could be some very specific issue relating to the way a broker-dealer is keeping its books. It could be a potential fraud, but virtually every one of them, particularly Corp Ben and OC, and of course John and the Enforcement Complaint Center, feed referrals to enforcement.
It's interesting because our office now, only 60 or 70% of our inventory is non-internet related because we service a lot of what the Complaint Center gives us. It historically, the number one source of leads for the commission has always been members of the public. It's interesting to read, we just had a complaint that came in yesterday from the GC at a big public company who said, I've got some problems here, and I've reported them, and nobody's listening to me. Mm. So there is an avenue. You've got to look at everything with a healthy dose of skepticism as well. You've got to realize that there might be someone who has their own agenda when they send you an email or a complaint. So it's very important to do extensive triage, I think, with very seasoned professionals. In our group, we have a lot of very, very experienced people reviewing these things, and that's the key. It's not just government that's looking at it. It's very experienced SEC lawyers who are going to talk to a lot of experts before they do anything, but at the same time act quickly if they have to.
Final question.
As an investor who reads the 10-Ks or annual reports or whatever, is there any improvement as far as the accounting firms are concerned? Are you all involved with that at all as to from an investor standpoint, relying on the letter from the accounting firm, is there any improvement in that from an investor standpoint now? With all the things that you've talked about with WorldCom and Enron and all these others, somewhere there's got to be a reliance on somebody's word. As a private investor, whether or not we have to, we can't be out there determining whether we have a Bernie Evers or Ken Lay, okay? We're relying on somebody. Are y'all working? I mean, is there an improvement?
I'll take a shot, and then, I think that, first of all, I mean, the commission takes accounting very seriously. Accounting issues were a large part of Sarbanes-Oxley. You see Section 404, which must include an accountant's attestation. And, I think you really see the corporation finance alone, I think, employs, I don't even know how many accountants, but we have several accountants, many accountants at the commission. They review these statements. We take it very the commission takes it very seriously. And, I think we are. All of the rules that the commission has promulgated really are to improve accounting. The commission oftentimes will take action, enforcement action against accounts to bar them from practicing before the commission. So the commission does have authority to reach out and to enforce the provisions that are implemented, that are implementing the ideals to enforce and to strengthen and make more transparent accounting. So I think my answer would be yes.
I want to thank our panel, Cheryl.